Today I'm going to be talking about some things I'm loving in books right now. And this is not a required list. I don't need every single one of these things in a book in order to love a book. I think there's room for enjoying all different types of stories. And there will be exceptions to everything I mentioned in the list, probably. And I'm sure there will be things I will think about after I finish filming this video that I wish I had included. But I thought this would be fun just, you know, for the spirit of Valentine's Day to talk about things I love in books. So starting off with number one is book structure. So something I've come to appreciate this last year is when an author takes a risk with a book structure and presents things in an unusual format. This could be a nested narrative or a different approach to narration, or maybe just not follow the typical rise and fall of action that we're used to. There are so many different ways to play with book structure, but I think that it takes a very skilled author to be able to do it and pull it off effectively and make it make sense. So it's something I've come to really appreciate when an author is able to do that. And kind of related to book structure has to do with foreshadowing, or when an author is able to sort of plant seeds along the way as you're reading. And those things might not seem significant when you're reading about them at first, but then when you finish the book and look back, you suddenly have a new context for those things, whether they are related to the plot or to a character or to a theme. I just find that so fascinating when an author is able to do that, because of course, being able to do that raises the reread value of a book. And then another thing that I really appreciate, of course, is theme. And I've mentioned themes before. Of course, I do love when authors explore certain themes that I love as it relates to fantasy, of course, like heroism and loyalty and leadership, things like that. But I particularly love it when a theme isn't totally obvious sometimes. That's something that I find really fascinating. For example, maybe I'll finish a book and I'll think of certain themes related to the book, and then I'll watch a video on a friend's channel and that person will bring up a theme I hadn't even thought about before. And it'll make me rethink the book or think of the book in a whole new way. And I love that because it'll make me appreciate the book on a different level I hadn't before. So I like it when themes aren't quite so obvious all the time. I like it when it's a little bit layered, a little bit more nuanced, and I really appreciate it when themes aren't presented in a way that give you specific answers or tell you how to think or how to feel, but are offered in such a way to raise more questions than answers and provide various perspectives on a theme rather than just one view of one theme. So I really appreciate that. And kind of related to themes, I think, are characters. So of course I love in-depth psychological explorations of characters. I love layered characters. I love characters that are not perfect, characters that make mistakes, that have good and bad qualities and everything in between. But I love characters that are layered, meaning that you might think you know them and over time you will learn more about them. Maybe they learn about themselves and maybe they're not always so obvious. So I really appreciate that. I think that could be really interesting just to have some kind of complexity to a character or some kind of layers to a character and maybe have the characters struggle with certain things. And then sort of related to that, of course, has to do with character dynamics because I love character dynamics. I love banter between characters. I find banter so much fun. I think it could be really amazing when an author is able to add wonderful humor between characters, but I love it when there are characters that don't allow our main protagonist to take themselves too seriously. So an example that comes to mind is The Witcher. I read those books years and years ago, and I recall a scene in one of the books. I don't remember which one now, but I seem to remember a scene in which some of the characters are kind of teasing Geralt a bit about how he's so moody and how he's brooding. And I thought it was so funny and so perfect that they didn't allow Geralt to take himself too seriously. And we all need a friend like that. We all need a friend who doesn't take us too seriously. And I appreciate an author who's able to do that, because sometimes I think, especially in fantasy, authors take their characters so seriously and want you to feel have such a serious perspective of that character. So I love it when we have side characters to poke holes through that illusion. And then related to character dynamics, I want to bring up something that I don't hear talked about a lot, and that is proximity between characters. So I guess because I am somewhat of a visual kinesthetic learner, I really appreciate when authors play with proximity, and meaning that you get a sense of where characters are in approximation with one another. You get a sense when a character is standing next to a character or in front of a character. I like it when characters touch one another, and it doesn't have to be a romantic thing, but if a character touches the other person's shoulder or hand at the right moment, not in an awkward way, but you know, in the right moment, or even if it's a way to build tension. Like I'm thinking of a book I read recently where one character put his hand on another character's throat and I felt it. I remember feeling it as though the character was touching my throat. So I think that could be very powerful to play with proximity or touch. And then going on from there, I love a strong sense of tone in my reading. I love to feel things, and I never gave as much thought to tone. Well, actually, I have thought about tone for a while now, but the one video that really clarified this for me was AP Canavan, A Critical Dragon's video on tone. He used an example from Reaper's Gale, The Lost and Book of the Fallen, Book 7. And this particular example is totally spoiler-free. You will not be spoiled for anything in the series if you watch that video, but he did such a good job illustrating how Erickson uses feeling words to bring a sense of tone into the setting and into the character's perspective. And I really had never thought before about how an author has that ability to make us feel a setting, not only feel a setting or feel what a setting feels like, but also relate it to the character's psychology and how the character is feeling and interacting with the setting, and how maybe what we're experiencing in the setting is related to that. Because I've seen those two things separate before. I've seen it where an author is presenting a setting and describing a setting in vivid detail, but it feels separate from the character's psychology, from what they're experiencing internally. But I love that in that example, I feel like those things are all combined within the character. So that's something I think is very powerful. And it's something that not only Erickson does, I think actually Tolkien does this too in The Lord of the Rings. The way he describes nature, I feel like he brings a strong sense of tone that's very different in his nature descriptions in The Fellowship of the Ring versus the nature descriptions in The Return of the King. And it's reflecting what the characters are experiencing as well. So I don't know that Tolkien was specifically trying to reflect the character's psychology, or say the other way around, that the setting is affecting the character rather than the character is projecting onto the setting, or vice versa. I feel like it could be explored in various ways, but I just find that exploration fascinating. And just tone in general to me is fascinating. I just love to, like I said, feel things in the prose. So that's something that I think has become more and more important to me as a reader. And then going on from here, I'm going to talk about other aspects of world building, including, of course, I love different cultures. I love different kinds of explorations on sociology, social structures. I love political intrigue, politics, all those things I won't go into depth about, but I will say about magic a little bit. One thing I've learned about myself when it comes to magic is that I really love magic. I love the magic in fantasy, but I do prefer softer magic these days. That's just where I'm at right now. I do appreciate that some authors like Sanderson and Brent Weeks are able to do these very elaborate magic systems and have that worked into the story very well. But for me personally, I just love a lot of mystery in my magic. But at the same time, I do like magic that has consequences, that has limitations. So I guess I'm asking for a lot as a reader, but I do like it. And I know a lot of authors do that well. So that's something I definitely appreciate. And I like a lot of weird stuff in my stories. I like a lot of weird things. And so this kind of goes into another thing I want to mention, which are battle scenes. I love battle, probably more than most readers these days. I don't know. It's interesting because I know a lot of people who don't really like battle scenes in their fantasy. And it's very difficult to write a very effective battle scene. That takes talent. It takes a lot of talent to do that. But I think that the authors who are able to write battle scenes that I like, that I prefer, are ones that are able to capture a sense of atmosphere and maybe have more than one type of thing going on, like a mixture of magic and battle is always fascinating to me. And just, I like it when I don't feel like it's just characters fighting characters, but maybe there's, you get a sense of the landscape, you get a sense of the sky, you get a sense, like I said, of the, maybe even a nature of the atmosphere. I just find that, like, that for me is so immersive. That is so fascinating. And of course, I like my battle scenes to sort of have an arc to them, in the sense I really do appreciate sort of the aftermath of war or the hardship of war after battle and the buildup to it too. Actually, when I think of a good battle scene, honestly, and it's my favorite symphony of all time, but I always think of the storm movement in Beethoven 6th. If you haven't heard it, go check out the storm movement. It's pretty short too. It's not a long piece, but that is the kind of battle I want. The battle of music in the storm movement in Beethoven 6th is what I'd love in a fantasy book. That's the way I'd want to feel. So again, I like to feel things. I do like to be intellectually stimulated, of course, and I like to think about things and think about these questions and themes. But more than anything, I want my fantasy or my books to bring me into my heart. So that's so important to me. And I know I'm mostly talking about fantasy here, but a lot of this can apply to other types of literature as well. Like I said, a lot of authors are able to do that. Some more than others. And again, this is not a total requirement. There are different types of stories, and I can appreciate different types of things. Of course, that's the beauty of literature. So let me know some things that you are loving in books right now. And if you've made it to the end of this video, because it's Valentine's Day, leave me a heart emoji, why not, if you'd like. And I just want to say that I wish you love wherever you are, whether you have a significant other or not. Know you are loved, and thank you so much for watching. Have a great rest of your day. Bye-bye.